So we're talking about the value of signatures, and I was sharing this thing called guardrails and closure. So I was telling Dave Thomas, Tudor, that that we're sort of that Eric and I were sort of following you into this part of the universe where there's no type signatures at the function level. And Dave Thomas, he laughs. He goes, "Yeah, like how many times you see a runtime error on a Tektronix oscilloscope?" It's like almost none, right? And that was all running on Smalltalk. So right. You're saying there are other ways to get safety than static typing, which I just thought was a delightful and somewhat kind of startling observation.
Yeah. And what is type safety in a distributed system when everything turns into bytes on a wire anyway? That's my other, JSON, no types. Go ahead. Sorry.
Exactly. Like, how many times do you just see JSONs being passed around, not even a schema or anything? And, people even glorify now databases without any of those types. So,
that's right.
And then you look inside the code, and then you'll see lots of just give me that key, and then in that key I assume that there'll be an array of something, and then I'll take something from there and I'll pass it around somewhere else, and nobody knows about the original. So and there's so much focus on just that little piece. And it can be useful, of course, especially if it's used okay. But there's like all this, recurrent subject, people are adding types to JavaScript. And so hence this must mean that types are so, like the ultimate thing. Right. But then nobody is adding the development experience to the runtime of JavaScript.
Right.
The problem is, is that when you're competing on, you have a dead file in front of you and you're trying to compete without any types against some language that has more types, then obviously the ones with more types will win there, because it's not a very particularly rich environment. But, and then again, it's not that types are not useful, but it's not the end of the conversation for sure.
And I bring it only because I just thought you were talking about a hole, Eric, and your thing. I'm like, here's something perfect to fill it. And I just find it so useful to at least think about types as you specify something. I found it so useful.
Mm-hmm.
For sure. Oh yeah. I think about them all the time. And I think that's one of the things that, the conversation that the industry has, at least what's on the surface that you see on the internet, is not that great. It bothers me, and I don't like to participate anymore. But one of the questions I get a lot, because I'm talking about I'm talking about using signatures and doing something similar to what's it called? Denotational design, which is it's kind of known in the Haskell world, and people are like, well, how do you do it without types? And I'm like, I have types, I just don't have the compiler complaining at me about them all the time. They're all in my head.
They're in my head, right?
They're in your head too. They're in my head, but I just don't have a compiler to check them for me. And yes, closurists think about types. We do. We have to. But we don't. We just don't make it part of our language.
Awesome. So I put the link in the Slack. Can I go through proposed agenda?
Sure.
Yes.
Right. And
I agree with it.
Okay. Good. In fact, I guess I'll bring it up for my own benefit. My machine's freezing up here. Could someone read it to me?
Yes, I'll read. Yikes, I lost all my changes because I forgot to save before exiting this morning. Tudor, can you show us how to recover these changes again? Show off any progress from Eric and me.
Yep.
State any desired outcomes for the day. Eric, I'd love to show you something. Guardrails type. Okay, you did that already. Tudor, to replicate some of what we've built to show us how an expert would do it. Q&A problem solving. That's it.
Yep, Erica, you up for that?
Yeah, that sounds great.
Okay. And I was going
to
show off.
I'd love to know how to save my stuff and use it in the new version, because every time I update, I don't know what to do.
Yeah. I would love to volunteer to be the guinea pig, because I forgot to save and I lost all my changes. So I can't show you what I built until I get the work back. So I thought I did it, but I did not. Oh, man. Am I?
While you're pulling that up, Tudor, I think I shared a video this morning. And I made another video, but it was uploading, so I couldn't share it at that time. I just linked to it. If you're interested, I don't want to give you work to do, but
no, he watches them. No. I can attest.
I will watch. I didn't have the time yet. Cool. But we'll take a look definitely.
I watched it.
Let me know if you
there you go.
Okay, let's see here. So
Google says that this is too large for Google to scan for viruses.
You just have to trust me. You just have to trust my computer.
I've fallen this for this before. Okay, let me pictures over here. I had to reboot my machine twice because I was on this thing. And then, as careful as I was, I forgot to save everything. I think I was supposed to click here and didn't. So. I went to the Morphic world and I thought I went into the right thing. This is from 7 days ago, all the way up to. A lot of changes here. Mm-hmm. So I thought what I did, I apply it.
Yes.
But.
And you can confirm. You have to say confirm.
Oh.
Yeah.
That's, damn it. Oh, you go.
Just to make some things clear.
Yeah.
So this is not a storage mechanism, right? This is an emergency mechanism. The image is not a code storage mechanism either.
Yeah.
Just like you would not store your modifications to a Docker image, for example, right? You wouldn't, you wouldn't save the Docker image.
Okay.
What you want is you want to externalize it and so that you can build a new image out of sources.
Right.
So I think maybe for next time, we can dedicate a session to just creating a project on GitHub.
Yeah.
Where you can publish your code and then load your code with one instruction in a new image.
Okay. Yeah. Sounds good. By the way, I'm a little bit concerned.
Not all changes?
Yeah.
So maybe there's a little issue there. Take a look at the, there in the filters. And there's this, the filters,
clean filters.
Clean filters. So I don't know what that one is, and then in there, again in the filters, they say show only latest changes. Probably this was the one, but okay. So this one should apply all changes.
And then do I pick the top one or the bottom one?
But that's the thing. So the every one of those are files on disk.
Uh-huh.
And they represent different sessions that you had.
Yeah.
So when you save an image, a new file will be created and it will be empty. So every one of these are the changes between two starting of the image.
Okay.
So every time you start an image, a new one of these session files are being created.
So
with all your changes.
I cannot for the life of me even guess which one. Do I need to do all of them or do I got to do?
Take a look at which ones have the changes.
Okay. Yeah. I think it's this one. Oops. So this is everything from 9/20 to 7 days ago.
Right. So if you look into the top one,
That's only
already
this morning.
Should have. Right. But you already have one from 12 PM, which is now, right?
Yeah.
Because you have just applied a whole bunch of changes.
Okay.
So
GK tweets.
If you don't exactly know what you have applied, then maybe go out and then come back and then we'll take the second one.
Quit?
Yeah, quit the image and start restart the image. From
should I save first?
No, don't save. Because if you say you don't know what you have loaded now.
Okay. All right. I'll just follow what you say.
Or the pro. So that's how you like restore it if you didn't save it. How do you get it into a new image if you did save it?
So you would put the code somewhere else, right? Not in the image.
So we'll go over that next time.
That place can be a GitHub repository. Okay. And then you will have a single command to load the code.
Yeah.
And that's it. You would just publish your code from. So okay, now you have to go to replay your changes.
I just want to actually see what. Yeah, something's not working here. So Morphic World.
Okay. Let's open this one again. Let's open another one again. This one is the one from today.
Yeah, that's this is what one. I want. Take
the one. That's the one. So now select all of them. Come on. Yeah.
No.
Yeah. Okay.
Confirm.
That looks better.
Okay,
doesn't we have G2 tweet and tweets, and it's like a reasonably small amount of code that you've just applied there. And now you can go back to your playground to see if this is okay. Yeah, maybe just execute something. Execute that one.
Sorry, I'm maybe it's this one here.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, tweets is nil. Why? That's working.
Those are not related, right?
No, I'm kind of being a little sloppy with my. Okay, so this is. I'll clean up a little bit here. Tweets is GK tweets new from a file, so this should work.
I'm getting right, a nil. So can you go into a call list and tweet simple, the views? Just change the view.
Yeah. Oh, those are my views.
Those are your views, yes. But indeed, something is not quite right. So if you can look at the file column.
Yes. It's a file. Fname is reference.
Right.
File.
This one only loads the JSON. So you're not populating tweets here at all.
Oh, then I have to do a create tweets. Ah, right. Create tweets.
Create tweets don't seem to exist, do they? Ah, yeah, on top. Yes, I see. So now you probably your views are much better now.
Okay. This is great. So maybe I'll just show you. So I managed to get this running.
Nice.
And so I was trying to. Wait a minute. Let's see here. Tweets. I was trying to get my, trying to render kind of, right. I guess what I'd love to get is just a bunch of these rendering here. I got pretty close. I think I even was starting to learn to make something that looked like this. In a columned list or something. So anyway, that's about as far as I got. And I.
Nice.
Great. And I guess maybe just to state a problem. I was wondering if there was a way to actually generate, just like how Eric was able to render one of these in isolation. Is there a way to render one of these views, but without the GT view
course.
Okay, great.
Of course. So we're going to go into this. Yes.
Perfect. All right. That's what I got done. And my goal is to get the collection of these guys running.
Yep.
Okay. Eric, I saw your video, by the way. That was I enjoyed watching it.
Okay. That was the old one, not the one from this morning.
From this morning, yeah.
Oh, from this morning. Oh, no, I posted it this morning, but I recorded.
Oh, yeah, yeah, right. Yeah,
okay.
And grab another tea over.
That was the
10 seconds.
Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah. Oh, I see. I'm looking here. So you have a planet.
Yes.
Wow, look at that. There's a planet.
I want to see a planet. What?
That's my new video.
I just looked at the movie. Just took a look at the movie. Nice. While you were having your tea.
It's a little longer than that. I got a planet going. I got it.
Yeah, I saw.
Having some fun there. I've got some physics going on, force due to gravity, probably wrong. Got the sum of forces.
Hey, can you share your screen?
Oh, you want me to do mine?
Yeah, sure.
Oh, right. This one. I was just making a little demo of it. Look, I can do it like this. Sun. Uh-oh.
I forgot. You're missing the dot of the new.
All right. So right now it's just generating random colored suns. You see that little thing right there? That's a sun.
You can see that, yeah.
Right. So this is my planet class. And I'll just go through them down the list. So this is the gravitational constant. Probably a little small for doing actual multiplications in floating point. But I just wanted to get something in there to get started.
I think that one should be better as a class method rather than as an instance method.
Oh, because it's a constant? Well, that's easy.
It's not particularly interesting. No. But of course, now every time you're doing self G, it won't work.
Well, that's just this one place. What do I have to do? Self class G?
There you go.
Boom. All right. You got to get out the way. There we go. All right. So let's go through acceleration. So as we know, F equals MA. So if you just divide the F by M, you get the A. So that's acceleration. And that's calling this delegating to force sum and mass. I have a center, which is, I call it center. I don't know what it really is, should be called. It's the thing that this planet is orbiting around. Center. So then I have the distance to the center squared, and this one I think works. It has to, because you might not have a center, so it has to check if it's nil. This code is probably really bad.
And that's not quite, is it? Okay, false. Oh, I see. So now if true, and then you have a, you need a block there.
It can't be zero.
Yeah, block zero.
Block zero. Got it.
So you're lucky because there is value in, so value is how you evaluate the block.
Right.
You also have value in object for now.
Right. So anything that's not a block, it just returns itself.
Yeah, basically. Which means that you can, if you have a block that returns a constant, you can just pass the constant everywhere a block is expected. And it will return if it's just a unary block, of course.
Is this best? Better practice to put it in
a block. Yeah, you should put it like this, yeah. Okay. That's what if true, false expects. But there's one other thing there, is that you have a return, you know, in the self center is nil, if true, false.
Yeah.
That's nice, but you do not need the return inside the if false.
Oh, okay.
Because that is going to be, you're always returning the last instruction.
Got it.
Basically. Here. Right, every time you're saying
in a block, yeah.
If you say return if true if false, you're going to return either the last instruction from if true or the last one from if false.
Right. Okay. So that's just
Command doing... Shift F would sort with order this a little better.
Would you say Command Shift F?
Yeah.
Oh, I did. That's nice. Oh man, I thought I was gonna wear out my space bar or something.
Okay. Nice.
That's good.
Yeah, exactly. Like that was, you see, it was very expensive to replace the MacBook Pro, the previous one. So then we figured it was because of the space bar got worn out. So that's why we introduced the formatting. Yeah, just kidding.
Nice. Right. So that's just doing, that's just squaring the difference between the two X's and the difference between the two Y's. Oh, this should be a plus.
So, of course, an example would be good about now here.
It would be, right?
Would be like
can I hit something. Command Enter here? No.
No. You would want to hit Command Enter to create a new method.
So this is, I had one in a playground. It's probably still there somewhere. Playground. It was on a different image, so I don't know how to get it back.
Oh, it doesn't matter. Shift Enter. Let's try. Shift That's right. Enter. Look, do a Shift Enter and then Planet. Right, and then you see, I see here Planet, new Planet, something.
There you go. There is my little thing. There's my demo. So I made a yellow sun and a blue.
Remember, Earth. Right? The playground is stored on disk every time you type.
Oh, okay.
And that one is irrespective of the. Because this is a knowledge management system.
Okay.
You're just using it for disparate pages.
Mm-hmm. So if I hit this, notice this is, it hasn't been set up with a center, so it's nil. So I get a zero, which is right.
Yeah. So that's cool.
And then I have to do Earth, center, sun.
Mm-hmm.
And someone's at the doorbell. So y'all talk amongst yourselves. I had to run. I'll be right back.
Right on.
So Gene, are you still having fun?
I am. It was a little, I felt like I kind of got caught in the barbed wire of, I had to understand the different block element layout editor things. So that was, it was super fun to be able to get the tweet entity working so quickly. Oh yeah, I had put into the Slack channel that to retype it. It took only like 7 minutes. So to do things the second time around was awesome. Then I had to learn the whole UI classes. That was a little bit daunting to do by myself. But I'm pretty pleased with where I got. And I guess I did realize that to put a class variable, I'm sorry, instance variable, just how much more leverage I would have gotten, right? Because I made like the self instance vars, right? To see how that would work and automatically populate the raw thing. I mean, that's really what I, if I use that, I get a lot of mileage out of that. So it's fun. Although it'll be a lot more fun once I'm through just like Eric is having more fun after he got through the translate by, right? I'll have a lot more fun once I'm past the UI widget things.
And I see that actually Eric got to relocate rather than translate by, which is great.
Yes.
Yeah,
it works Eric now. I think your camera, is it on? Oh.
You don't see me?
Oh, there you go.
Oh, yeah, we do. Did you understand the difference now between relocate and translate by?
No. I don't know why it started working. It wasn't working before and now it works.
Mm-hmm. So relocate actually moves the object and layout is affected. Translate by is a transformation that does not affect the layout. It's just pure visual effect. It's a transformation, so transform do.
Okay.
And for example, if you want to do a jiggling animation, the bounds of the entities will not be affected during that animation.
I see. Got it. Okay. Right. So this should work now. Okay, there we go. I changed it here, but it didn't change it here. That's what's confusing me. So Earth raw preview 0.0. That shouldn't be right. Oh no, my distance calculation is wrong. Because see, this one is centered. Well, it's centered. Yeah, now we gotta.
Okay, may I? Should be like one of the things you can, maybe we can just give it a try. Because like you need assertions now here, right? Because like just doing it like this doesn't quite work so well.
Okay.
Doesn't scale for longer than a few things.
Mm-hmm.
So if you go back to the playground, right? We could, for example, if you take the second snippet, planet new, center this two, you would want to, the second snippet, yep, you would want to say, for example, self assert equals 0.0, right? No, it's like before. So self assert. Yeah, right at the beginning, you want to say.
Yeah, I'm trying to. You get want to assert that self assert.
Yeah. Colon.
Okay.
You need a colon. So.
Uh huh.
Mm-hmm. Now you have that planet new center this two, and then you say that this one equals zero, I guess.
Equals zero, right? Like that.
Right, and try to execute that. Yeah, that's good. It wouldn't have executed if it would have not been true. So what you can do now, and again, like this is just something we're playing with right now, but the idea is we want to bring everything to where you always have a self, right? This is what we understand by live programming. So program against an existing self,
uh-huh,
where you have actual data, actual objects in front of you, so that we do not have to compete where the editor is dead. So but now you see, like you wrote here essentially what would be equating to a test.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Right. So you can, in the bottom right of that snippet, there is a hamburger menu. And you can say EG. And it's again, like just make a, create a class there, say planet example, for example. So double click, you know, like the, we still have to work on it. This is just a prototype. Planet example or examples.
Oh.
And you can say enter again. And, mm-hmm. Okay, and then you need a selector for it. So let's say empty planet or something.
Like that?
Yeah, for example. And then put the package, the one you were in, where the planet was. Okay, Eric, enter. Say okay. Oh no. Nah, never mind. That should have worked, but there is an issue in your image.
Just I think I know what you're doing. By the way, one of the things I did was actually convert the strings into date, the Z timestamp class.
Mm-hmm.
And it was awesome just having all those examples. Just it was really really awesome just to see.
Yeah,
it was a combination test slash examples,
right? This one is not, yeah, later? Exactly. Yeah. So this one, basically the idea here is, well, next time we'll fix this. I don't know why this is problematic. It's not gonna work.
Yeah, okay,
there's an issue. But basically here we're saying we would have transformed this one into a method that returns this result. So you go from a playground seamlessly to a
place which you can,
right?
A planet and examples class.
Right. And that also then becomes a test. So you go from playground is where you prototype things and then you promote it and say, okay, let's put it into continuous integration.
Awesome. Yeah, that's a great idea. I love that.
And so, and then you can do lots in the playground where, and then inspector, because this is where we want to, and a little bit in the debugger, that's where we want to have the development experience.
Mm-hmm.
And the coder part is mostly for organizing things. Not
what would you have named the class in that? I'm sorry, what would you name the method? Like test planets or
empty?
Something?
No, I would have called it an empty planet. You can actually empty do planets. It if you want. You can go to where your planet class is or the planet coder is, And let's create there, just play plus and create a new class called planet examples. Yeah, there you go.
Oh, it did get created.
No, it didn't.
No, it was in the autocomplete.
Oh, then it's created then. You can actually, you can make, if you maximize the planet pane. Yeah, exactly. So it's created. That's why you can't.
Yeah.
If you maximize the planet in the, if you maximize the pane. All right, there it is.
Ah.
But it doesn't have a method. So let's add a method here. And let's call it, okay, empty.
No center. Planet. A planet empty without planet, center.
Or no center, planet with no, without center. That sounds great. And then, and then you can say P equals.
Oh.
Okay. Yeah, it's good.
Okay. Well, I have to return it though, right?
Exactly, but you can extract it afterwards if you want.
And should this be an instance?
Oh.
Okay.
Go ahead. You don't have to return it if you don't want to. So if you don't return it, it's going to have a return the planet example. So it's not going to be meaningful.
Planet new.
I'm going to make one of these.
Right, like this. And then you do a return P, right? So save it. So nothing happens here. You just save it. Okay. So nothing happens here, right? You have this. And now go and there where you have this, this is a new method string.
Why is it showing up twice?
Comment. It's a bug.
Yeah. Don't delete it.
No, don't delete it.
Yeah, I ran into that yesterday.
Good point. Yeah. We just opened that bug. So in that comment, this is a new method where that comment is. So you can delete that, obviously. And not in the method, you have to put a pragma called GT example. And the pragma is angle brackets, GT example.
Like that?
If you close the angle bracket. Okay. Now notice how as you were typing, new sets of buttons appear at the bottom.
Yes. Oh, yes.
Okay.
You have the EG.
Okay. You can click on that. Yeah.
The EG?
Yeah. Click on the inspect now.
Oh, inspect.
On the inspector. Yeah. So that got you the planet, which actually means that now you have you've just transformed your code editor into a playground.
Right.
There's no difference really between them.
Right.
And that's where the difference is, right? Between examples and tests. So you can put your assertion there, like self-assert, P center dist equals zero.
Hey Tudor, how do you
need the
get that maximized view where you could create new classes?
There's a plus button on the left, top left side of every
page. Do I need this paren?
No, you don't.
Equals zero.
Yeah, and you put a dot. Right, and now you can still.
Okay.
And so now what you got here is you can build, you have an object, you have asserted that is interesting for whatever reason. And then you can play with it. And this can actually be tested continuously by your continuous integration.
Uh-huh.
Right? Now let's just humor me a bit. And though there's this 1, 2, 3, 4.
Wait, can we have it tested automatically every time I update the methods?
Of course. Not yet, but yes.
Okay.
But basically this is what we are running. This is a unit test and this is what we're running on the continuous integration, for example.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Can I pause for a second? So I have my class up, but when I hit the plus button, I don't get that class explorer.
Can you show me which plus button are you showing?
Okay, yeah. Sorry. Can I do the screen for me? So I want to make one of these too, but I can't. I have the playground on the right, and I'm trying to figure out how to make a
just a second. So let's see, what do we have here? Can you describe to me what you have in the second pane?
It's an AGK2 tweets,
which is, what is that? Is it a class or is it an instance of that?
It's
class?
An instance.
It's an instance of that class, right? And you're looking now at the meta view of that class.
Yes.
And so now if you just, for example, click on where click on there. Yes. And now Command B, remember from browse?
oh, I've never used that before. Oh, and if I do, hey, all right, cool.
Right. So yeah. This is one, but there's another one. There's another way, which is maybe faster. So if you minimize this one again.
Yeah.
Okay, then you see.
Oh, I'm sorry. Actually, I had a question about this. So if I do this and I go browser, if I wanted to make this a tab, can I do that?
Yeah, exactly. So you have this icon with the book.
Yes.
That's a browse button. And it will open it. And you also see it in the inspector. That's what I wanted to show you.
Where?
You have to, now you open this one in the new browser pane. So you have to command shift left. So until you find your other browser.
Oh.
Your other pane. Yeah. Right. Okay.
Okay.
Okay. So here, if you go to the left here.
Yeah.
You see that the GK2 tweets.
Yep.
Gray bar, there's also, you find that book icon in that gray bar.
Oh,
that one will be browsing the class in a new tab.
Oh, in a new tab.
Right. So if you scroll through the tabs, you will see that it's at the end of it.
Okay. I have put in a request with a trackball. I can't see that. Let me try to use a trackpad here. And my trackpad is not working. Okay, got it. I will take your word for it. Okay, and I'm using Command Shift square bracket and to flip between them. Yeah. Okay. Thank you. I'll turn back over to you, Eric.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Right. I was just thinking about what to call my center, because I think I want center to be the center point of the planet, not the object at the center of its orbit. I don't know what that's called. I'm looking it up in a dictionary. What do you call it? Like, what's okay? You have a satellite, but what's the other thing that it's orbiting around? I don't know.
Technically, they're orbiting around each other.
That's true. But we all know that sometimes one is way bigger than the other one.
Planet and satellite?
It's common center of mass.
Common center of mass.
I think.
What? Well, that's the, right, technically what it's rotating around.
But what was it?
What is the, like, If the moon is the satellite, what is the Earth? And if the Earth is the satellite, what is the sun?
The thing,
that thing in the middle. All right. So let's, what else do you want to see? What should I do now? I've got my examples. Is there a way to run all examples?
Yeah. Right. Again, like, I think this is doesn't refresh properly now. Normally, there is one. You know, right now, you just have one of them. So you would have a button that appears on the top right to run all examples.
Okay. Should I close this and reopen it?
Can if you want.
Hey, actually, before you do that, Eric, so you're creating this local variable P, and then you're returning that.
That's right. And I'm making a bunch of assertions on it.
Yeah. So no problem with that. It's like returning a local variable. That's cool.
Why should there be a problem?
Just confirming. Yeah, because I'm doing the same thing.
And the cool thing is you can run it and you get it.
Yeah.
So cool. If you press EG, that's actually the object behind the example. This is a meta object, which can, if you have dependencies, would be able to show you dependencies and run them in arbitrary, in which order you might want.
Cool.
So for example, last time you played with animations.
Mm-hmm.
So if you search for BL animation examples, is this a new image?
Yeah, just got it like an hour ago.
Great. Mm-hmm. You see there, there's an examples map view. Mm-hmm. So what this one here says is that like this example, like normally tests are just isolated, right? And you don't know, you have to have the map in your head. But here you have examples, because example are just method that I can just call. There's nothing in between.
Right.
I can build a graph of these examples.
Right.
And which means that if something fails at the top, right? So if I want to understand, if I look at this one, I say, well, how do I start reading? Because I have like, I don't know, 30 different examples here. So where do I start from? I'm going to start probably from left to right, just to figure out what are the examples about. And then when I will try to understand a long one like this, I'm going to go from right to left.
Hmm.
Because like so those
the
are
the graph changed.
It rearranges. Yeah, because the layout maybe is not stable because there are just too many dependencies. But
right, okay. So I can go for one of these. This one, the ones on the right have no dependencies.
Exactly, right? Okay.
So there's,
which means that that's like the smallest piece exactly. out of which I'm going to construct a large piece.
Got it.
Now, and then the other thing that you can do with this, right? So if you go back to your planet examples, and can you, like the fifth icon at the bottom in your example.
This one?
That one.
That's awesome.
Yeah, that will copy the name of it, right? Oh. So copy that one. And can you go to the playground? So here to the playground, now press Command Shift Enter to add the new snippet, but of a different kind. And here, just choose example. So this is going to be a different type of snippet. And I'll paste the thing that you have. It's the name of your method. So now that it brought your example over there. And this one now is embedded into your your page, right? So you can have your, because you can, this can be like, as I said, it can be documentation.
Right. Example. I can put some text and explain it. And
then you explain it, but you can do a little bit more. So if you put, for example, a pipe and then you say no code equal true.
Pipe, no code like this.
Capital C.
Capital T?
No, small cap.
Oh.
Then you've just embedded the inspector, right? It says execute it automatically, and then you get the inspector in there. And then of course here you can say, I just want a certain view of the inspector, and then you're gonna embed that one. And this is now how we're gonna create documentation about various pieces of a scenario, right? So mm-hmm. examples, then document the scenario, but then I can also start using various pieces inside to construct narratives out of it. And so you notice here how the normal effort of, you know, like what people call test-driven development is immediately, like it's also the unit of documentation because there is no friction.
Right.
But we needed to rethink what a test is. And so that's where these examples come into
that's
play,
awesome.
Right? So you can
love it.
So right, it's just a continuum.
Yeah. Cool. Mm-hmm. I know on the agenda, one of the things that we thought would be good was to have you show us how to replicate mm-hmm. what we've done. I'd love to see that now.
Okay, so I'm gonna share the screen. Mm-hmm. I cannot share the screen while the other participants are sharing. Now I can, I guess. So let's start. So
please do show off.
Yes.
Uh-oh, here he goes. All right, what is this?
So I'm looking at, I already prepared some of my data from Twitter. It's a bit older, but doesn't matter. So you can see here, user fincom, and I can go in there and I can see, for example, data. I don't know exactly what I have here, and I guess somewhere there's something.
Yeah, by the way, can we do verbal commentary as we go?
Yeah, please.
So Eric, I use that as file reference to open up my files, uh-huh. right? And it's like so cool that you can just sort of like just go call it on dot and then view it in the viewer. That's really wild.
That's so nice, yeah.
So here in the data, I'm going to now say I'm looking for messages. Oh, these are direct messages. That's not what I'm looking for. Maybe tweets.
It's tweet.js.
There's it. There's tweet.js.
Yeah.
So that's interesting.
No code.
Hmm? Oh, it's a massive assignment of a JSON.
Oh, it's rendering. I see.
It's just an assignment of a JSON, right?
Yeah.
So let's quickly take a look at that. Maybe we should have picked something that is smaller. Eh. Oh, that's beautiful. This is how you should export data, right? okay, what do I have here? I don't know what I have here. So what I would like to do, of course, and I don't want to see this. So now that I know what this one is, I'm going to actually take this file over here and I'm going to paste it here. And I'm going to say tweet.js. And then, and then this is the file. This is the file. And then from this one, I'm going to just quickly try. So here at the end of it, I saw that it's just something like this. So I'm going to just try something out here because I don't know exactly. So if given something like this, I probably need to remove this part here in order to parse it properly. So let's see, remove prefix, I guess. I'm just going to do something barbaric here. That's good enough, I guess. And right. Okay, that looks like good. So great, which means that if I take this one now and I say my tweet, JS, and then I say contents to this. Actually, let's just take the contents once. And then I'm gonna say, so I'm gonna read the contents. Contents was sent to Neil, of course, because I didn't initialize this one. So I'm gonna initialize that one, great. And say contents, remove prefix, oops. And I'm going to say just the first 1,000, just to make it easy. Remove prefix contents, of course. So when I execute this, it kind of looks good. So great. Now I have my contents are nice. Okay, and then I say, this is my JSON. And I'm going to execute that one. And now I'm going to have my some JSON. I don't know. I think it's from string. And then I'm going to get JSON here. Let's see if this one works. Okay, look at that. That one works. So array. So now I'm going to have an array here. And then what I want is to basically go through each of them. So this array now is, I'm gonna say my Twitter. So you called it tweets, right? But it's just not, because like, for example, if I say it's my tweets, right? Maybe Twitter feed. Let's just call it my Twitter feed. And I'm going to say an array, so maybe raw data. This is actually a pattern that we're using. We're taking that array and just passing it as being a raw data. So I'm going to create this class over here. The package is showing off. And that sounds good. And I'm going to create the raw data here and say raw data is the array. Now, of course, this one doesn't exist. I'm going to create a slot here. Great. So I'm going to do this, which is great. So now, of course, the first thing I want to see is I want to see this raw data right in place here. So I'm going to now create a class here. So gt raw data or a view. And I'm going to say return a view. And this is going to be a GT view, right? As we know it. And then I'm going to say at this moment it's just a normal list and the title is raw data. It's going to have items in it and the items are going to be the array. Sorry, it's not the array. It is, what is it?
Raw data.
Raw data, right? There it is. So now I have my raw data. Okay. Then I have it here. Great. Now, of course, what I would
Could you go back 10 seconds? Sorry. Like I had a little momentary lapse of attention. Get raw data for, right. Items is raw data.
I just want to see the raw data.
Yeah.
Just to not have to work too much.
Perfect. Got it. Yep.
Okay. So I go back to my, and I have a feed object, right? You know what I would like to a feed, for example, I would like to see tweets from it. Because this sounds like a nice thing to do with a from a feed that you want to tweet. So I'm going to create a tweets object here, of course.
Oh, a quick question. So one of the problems I had was that when I made that GT view, like whenever I change it, I felt like I actually had to create a new feed in order to, it wouldn't update the, my changes wouldn't be reflected in the view.
Normally it should. If it's not, like there can be many cases and
okay.
We're trying to refresh it in most situations.
Okay, Roger. Thanks.
That we can, but if it's also possible that maybe something's broken, but normally it shouldn't be.
All right.
So if I say here, I have this raw data. So I have this, how do I get the tweets? Well, basically I now have the raw data and I'm gonna collect from here, given an array. Actually, no, it's a dictionary, right? Actually, I don't know what it is, so I forgot, which means that I'm gonna, I can't do it from here, but yeah, it's a dictionary. So, and I'm gonna say, I want my tweet. And I'm gonna pass the raw data in it, and it's gonna be the dictionary. So now, of course, this one doesn't exist, so I should create it. It's correct. And the raw data is, I'm just gonna do another one. Raw data equals a dictionary over here. I'm gonna add a slot here. I'm gonna save this. I'm gonna save this. And now I'm gonna do that. This, which means that I will get the array of my tweets. All right, so now my tweet now has I get to a point where I get my tweet with raw data. And so one thing here, I don't like to work with this array. I hate that I have this one in between. So in fact, I want to go back to my feed. And of course now here would be great to just have here, GT tweets for, and then I'm gonna say, any view here. And I'm gonna say a view, and it's gonna be again the list, and then the title here is tweets. And make this one the first thing I wanna see. Then the items here are gonna be self tweets, right? So when I save this one, I get my tweets, and that's great, right? So now I have my tweet. Now I can work with the tweet. So now, like basically I went through the thing that I knew, and then I drilled into. But now I have, I reified my objects because it kind of forced me to, right? Because now I want to create a visualization of my tweet, right? So let's actually learn something from here, but we don't know anything from here because the raw data is there. So I want to see the raw data first, which again, like I can do exactly like what I've done here. What I will do now is I won't try to generalize too much because just, I don't know exactly. Like here, I see an array, here's a dictionary, so it's okay. I'm just gonna say, this is going to be a column list, and this is also raw data. The items are those. I take the associations from here and then say a column, which is going to be the property. And the text is.
So associations is a method of dictionary.
Dictionary.
Yeah.
Right. Okay. And then I'm going to say the value over here, and then the text of it is going to be the value. So when I save this, I get my raw data. It's kind of simple. Okay. It's actually not that interesting.
That was an hour trying to make that work, by the way. This is beautiful.
So a more interesting view here would be actually, right, because it's not nice. I would like to actually be able to drill into it better. So if I actually go into this raw data,
I should see here. Can I pause for a second here? Where I tried to find, I was looking at examples of GT views. Like, is there a manual for this anywhere?
Yeah. So if you say inspector views, there's an actual page here, which would teach you pretty much everything you need to know about it. So with interactive examples.
Dang.
For example, something like this here.
Yeah.
And you can even say,
okay, awesome, like awesome. In fact, I even studied that contact card address book example, so, but I didn't see this.
Right. So this is where to look in the inspector views.
Oh.
Okay, good. So I have this tree in the dictionary, which is a kind of a nice thing, but I would like to have it in this raw data over there.
Yeah.
So let's see, what's the name of it? Actually, that's this one is GT3 for our context, great. Which means that if I go in my tweet over here, I maybe don't want to see everything here. So I will just, I will say I want to forward this one. This is gonna be the title. And I think this one asks me for an object, and the object is going to be raw data. And I think it wants me to look for a selector, but actually I don't know. So I don't have to remember this. I'm going to look for senders of this. So this kind of looks okay. And look at this. So it's a view forward object and then a view. Okay. It's not a selector, it's the view. And then I'm just going to paste.
And you did that. Like, was that an implementer? Command M to get that.
Command view? N from references.
References. Okay. Yeah. Yeah. Right. Thank you.
There's an N in references. You see.
Yeah. 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 Right.
So if I save this one.
Wait, I'm sorry. Could you go? Could you go back to the reference again?
So I'm going here and I'm pressing Command N.
Yep.
And I'm here.
So how, why did you put colon context?
This was before. So when I was looking at the raw and I looked at the raw data, I looked at dictionary.
Yeah.
This is a dictionary, right?
Yeah.
And now I'm looking, which views do I like? This is a nice view. Items is one.
Totally, totally.
But I kind of like this one better.
Yeah, yeah, totally.
It has gray things in it.
Yeah.
I don't know. I just picked this one.
Right.
And
right.
Then I say, what is the name of this one? Then I come out, then I alt clicked on it.
Yep.
And I saw this name. And then I copied that method. And then I go back.
Context.
So notice how there is this kind of, you know, it's like you have a bridge point and then you're gonna explore a bit.
Love it. But can you go to meta and then go into the GT view? Could you read the view colon GT34 colon context colon? What is that?
This is the name of this method. This is a symbol.
Yeah.
Pointing to this one.
That's the name of the method.
That's the name of the method. It's the selector of this method.
It has two arguments.
This method over here. That's the name of it.
GT tree view takes a view.
This is the same as if in Java I would have a method like this.
Yeah. Right. Okay. I think I got that. But in the call, when you send the message or when you forward it.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. So I need to forward it to some object that I lazily compute.
Yep.
And and I want to forward it to a specific view. Which view?
One that is
implemented by some method in this object.
Yeah, I would have put GTTree4 without the colon, context colon. I'm trying to figure out where you how one That's, would know.
This is the name of the method that implements the GTView. Got and it. I know that this one because I alt-clicked here.
Yeah. Okay, I'm sorry. I didn't parse that right. Okay, so the name is GTTree4
colon context colon.
Okay, yeah. Got it. I would have only grabbed the first part.
Okay. Exactly. Okay, good. So now we have this. So let's see. I don't know what I'm seeing here. So I see full text. That sounds like nice. So let's actually, I'm going to just say here, in this place over here, I'm going to say data at tweet, I think it was. Yeah, that sounds good. And then, at full underscore text. It sounds also good. That sounds like a...
yeah. Awesome. Okay. And I'm sorry, pound tweet is exactly what?
A symbol.
It's a symbol.
It's a symbol, which is a kind of a string. I can also put a string here.
Oh. Oh.
Display text range. Got it. Okay. Sounds good. Contributors. Yeah, it sounds like a nice thing. So I could say this one over here would be nice to have directly here. Something which says full text. I'm gonna return this. So now, because this is now a unary method, and I have an object, I can also execute it. And I can see the result in place, right? I don't need to go to the playground necessarily. And then actually, this could also be a nice representation of these objects. So GT full text for a view, GT view, I'm gonna say a view, I'm gonna say text editor, I think there's one. And the title is full text, and the text, I think, it's called self full text. And if I save this one, I should have this one over here. Oh, great. So now, at least I have a little browser, right? So now I'm here.
Can I interrupt with two questions? And maybe, Eric, you dig in? That's awesome. It really is.
It's awesome. Yeah, go for your questions.
Well, actually, what is so awesome to you, by the way? I have a grin on my face.
Yeah. What's awesome is that I'm still amazed by how fast you can build up a UI by using the existing components, and you're doing it without ever losing context. Like, feels like you Tudor is saying stuff like, well, it kind of wants me to do this, and so I'm just gonna do it. Like, I love that feeling when it's so clear what to do next that it seems like the thing is telling you to do it. But look at this, he's got a UI of tweets parsed out of a JSON.
Yeah.
And I like, so just as the thing I know the best is closure, and it would be very interactive, but it's all interactive through code. So if I want to see something, I have to write some code to get like the 10th one out, right?
Yeah.
Which I'm very used to doing, but this lets you build a UI super quickly and browse it in a more laid back, mousy way. I like that.
Awesome. But by the way, I mean, he's like 90 seconds away from having images being rendered too, which is like really nuts. Okay. So here's two questions I have, just having kind of, Like for every minute he covered is like an hour I lived. I'm not complaining. It is really awesome. By the way, it's always awesome to see people, maestros at the craft. Yeah. Yeah, just at work. I have two questions. One is every time I try to make a GT view, I would get an error because I had no idea when I was doing like with the text editor and collections. And so part of me was wondering like, okay, can I write those in the playground so that I could just get a little more something? That's question number one. And then two is I did exactly what you did. And about 3 hours in, I was wondering if I was actually making a mistake by not creating instance variables, where I felt like if I just made an instance variable, I could leverage a whole bunch of existing machinery that could just render them. So I'm wondering kind of what goes through your head as you think, you know, do I just sort of get these kind of getters to reach into the dictionary and at what point would you even think about making that an instance variable? So those are my two big questions I have right now.
Well, so like here, I have a bunch of instance variables, but they are hidden in this JSON, right?
Yeah.
So like normally people may just take one of these and send it to something. And that's kind of, that's problematic because here you have a structure. And normally people would just work with a dictionary, but this is just such a poor vocabulary.
Right.
But if I give it a name and this is saying this is a tweet, and I'm going to say, okay, full text is interesting. Let's take something because I just took the string, but here's another one created at.
Yeah.
So right here, I would say created at. Right, and I can see that string, and I can say, I think you had one. What was it, like Z timestamp?
Z timestamp, Can't just make a joke here. I felt very good that in 45 minutes, I experienced that even small talkers, gruesome treatment of date and time. It's like as gruesome as anywhere else, but it wasn't bad.
But actually, date and time is actually not so bad.
Yeah, it was a Z timestamp. Formatter.
Right, but date and time should be good enough. So if I browse date and time, I should I think here something like string. There's a class method called from string that kind of like sounds the right thing here to do. So date and time and say from string. Let's see if this one works out. No, actually it doesn't, because it doesn't accept something here. Let's actually take a look at the class methods. So there are all these class methods. So from string, that kind of should be the one.
Is it from ISO 8601? Is there one of those?
No.
Maybe.
No, it's a custom thing.
No, that is ISO.
No, this is it. Is. I'm sorry. Yeah. Okay, we don't have this. So, one thing we could do is we could actually write a parser if you want to, because why not? So should we do that?
Yeah, I would love to see what you can do with once you have it into
a parser.
No. Once you have it into a real date time, like what kind of beautiful visualizations can you do? Or can I just give you my code to do that? Sure. Eric, watch this.
What kind of a timestamp is that?
It's custom. It's terrible.
Yeah. So throw away the first three characters because that's useless. Then the oct has to get turned into October. Can you split it on strings?
Sure.
Tudor, here you go.
Oh, he's already got it done.
Damn it.
Let's see. Tweet. From string parse. Oh.
Yeah. Oh, let me have my moment of triumph.
There you go. Okay, let's do this. the timestamp format from string.
Yeah.
Oh, really?
Format from That's string and nice. Then parse it.
Like this?
Yep.
Does not sound right. Because I don't have time that timestamp format.
Where'd you get that? Image.
From Monticello.
Right, but I'm not gonna do that.
Okay.
Let's see if I'm gonna just take this one here. Does this one look better? That looks better. So I'm gonna say Albert first four. And then let's say tick. Looks okay. Oh, there it is. So that's like a nice thing to do. So
wait. That's actually a date time.
If you take off the day name, the name of the day. It works.
So that's gonna be my creation timestamp, right? So I can
we see what's a type. So that really is a date and time. God, that's so cool. All right, awesome.
Okay, and now
what 45 minutes right there.
we need to go to these tweets. And of course now I'm not gonna see a list here. I want to see a column list here. Column list. And this column list is gonna have indeed the tweets. But now I'm gonna have two columns here because it's nice. So column one is gonna be date. And then the text in it is gonna be the, what was it? Creation timestamp. And then there's gonna be another one with the full text. And the text in it is gonna be full text.
So when you say symbol like that,
it's creation almost timestamp. Working, but it's not quite working.
Yeah. So that creation timestamp, you're just saying that symbol is basically like a call. Is that correct? That
This is equivalent, right? So so this is a symbol.
Yeah.
This one here actually expects a let me say each tweet. So you can say each tweet full text. This would be equivalent, these two things. But if I look at the symbol here, if I look at the symbol class, I'm going to see that there is a method here called value. And the way this value symbol is implemented is actually given a symbol and an object that I get as a parameter is going to perform self, this thing, onto this object, which means that can basically, if I have a unary method here, this full text is a unary method, and I have this object passed to here, which means that I can just
Okay, that's cool.
Right, so then I have this, but the kind of like this one doesn't work.
The time didn't get parsed, right?
So let's actually just look into this quickly. Let's see why self was it raw data. Actually, I'm gonna just do here. Let's take a look at what is this. It doesn't like something. I think it doesn't like that this is.
No, it said the time, the hour has to be less than 12. So it doesn't like the 14.
Oh, gee. Yeah. Well, that's not nice. Must be
hour must be 24 or less. Oh,
maybe it doesn't like something else.
Is that 50?
You are lucky with this one. So we were lucky with this one, but really here, what we would need is just, right, because you know, so this one here, if I look at this, no, actually, this one it should be the same, fascinating, but we could just write, I would write a parser for this, because it's just too annoying.
No, we'll do that at some other time. I mean, we know how to parse.
Great.
It takes a long time.
Okay, so we would have something like this, right? And then I have my date and full text over here. This would be something. Now, there are a couple of things here. What we didn't do at all is our examples. At this point, because I have already done things, I've probably already started to think about examples, but I'm also at the place where I still get to learn the data. So I don't exactly know what kind of assertions do I need to make yet. So for example, here, this is one way to test. This is kind of hard to, it's kind of hard to how would you do it, right? So when you know exactly what the assertion is, then you can start with a test. But if you don't know what the assertion is, then you don't. And you need to see, because like you see, there's a good deal of cases where you would be correct, where the inference would be correct, right? But then there are others. So without visualizing this, you just wouldn't.
That's right.
You're not equipped in the right way.
Right.
So that's one thing. The other thing is about the, you know, we're talking right at the beginning about modeling. It's it tells me, because I want to have a view which just says, give me the text of this tweet, right? Because I want that, I need to give it a name. I need a tweet object. So otherwise I don't have where to put the view.
Yep.
And this is why, like, this is an orthogonal, it's a feedback loop that is orthogonal to the tests. It's a way of massaging the design space in a way that tests don't necessarily, because I can write assertions just with dictionaries and it would just be fine.
Yep.
But it's not enough. Like, so this is a way of looking at it in a way that if you're just looking at tests, it's just a unidimensional thing, but it's actually a two-dimensional thing, and you would just miss it.
So I'm dying, Eric, if it's okay with you. So can I propose a direction? To
the cards.
I'm sorry?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. So Eric, if it's okay with you, what I would love to, see the images, and then how would you compose that into the view?
Yeah. Mm. So, okay, now let's look at this about what is this view? Because like we just talked about views and views, but what exactly is it that we have in front of us? So I'm going to now press Control Option Shift. And this is like essentially like a visual inspector, right? And so I can click here, and now I go into something called a scene driller, which is like not unlike your DOM inspector, basically.
Yeah.
Okay. Now notice how here the whole thing, everything, all the way to the world, all the way to a single word inside my text, and I can actually double click on it and see what's in there.
cool.
Like an end, for example, that one. This is a word in the text editor. It's still in the single same tree. This is a particular thing that we spend a lot of time working on, which is this idea of having exactly a single rendering tree for anything we want to show on the screen. And so there's exactly one DOM with one abstraction.
By the way, just to marvel a little bit. So everything is in the DOM, including the DOM browser, or the element browser.
Of course. Yes.
Yeah, that's Eric, that's pretty cool.
So at the end of the day, right, if you look here, you don't see any views. So here's an editor, this is this, and I can see, okay, look at that one, right? This is the tabs, and somewhere here, maybe make it larger, and this one.
Okay.
So if I look at this, right, I can have, these are the tabs. And somewhere here, this is a scrollable element. That's why you can scroll through it with the mouse. And these are the tabs, right? So the view that we have defined, full text and the editor, are two different elements in two different parts of the DOM. Yeah. Make sense?
Yep.
So when we are composing a scene, we're actually not composing views. Views are just nice utility so that it's like a higher level API to just generate stuff in the actual DOM, right? So but if you want to see how do you compose things out of elements, like visual elements, then we have to go and learn how these elements are composable. So it's at the lower level abstraction. The views will not particularly provide us with a lot of details. They're actually mostly examples for what you can put together. Okay, make sense?
I think so. Somewhat. Okay. Eager to hear why you're showing this. It's interesting.
So because you need to understand, like right now you're saying, I want a card. Now there's no view that has cards for tweets. Right. Nobody knows what you have in mind. So I now need to construct an actual element. Right. Okay, so so I'm gonna say one about element. And so let's say this is gonna be a container. And I'm gonna return that container, and in that this container, it's gonna have constraints. Actually, yeah, let's do it like this for now. And I'm gonna say vertical. I'm gonna sell it to fit content. And the horizontal should also fit content. And then I also
can you give like just 15 seconds on what content fit content means versus what other?
Right. So we want a card that fits the content of the editor, for example. Or maybe we can say there's going to be an exact, so vertically it will fit content, so it will grow as much as needed, but horizontally it will be exact.
Okay.
I don't know.
Thank you.
400 pixels, for example. And then I'm going to say here, I want to lay out, because in this card, I'm going to put at least an editor. So.
Wait, did you forget the horizontal?
Yeah, very nice. Horizontal. So vertical here. Actually, let's actually take a look. Oh, of course, there's nothing in there. okay, and then what do I do here? I would say in the container, I'm gonna add child, and in that child, I'm gonna put what? I will put an editor in there, and in this editor, I'm gonna put the self full text. That's gonna be the text, and I'm gonna say it needs to have an aptitude of glamorous editor. Regular editor aptitude, and this one should be horizontal match parent and vertical fit content. And so if I execute this one, I'm gonna have this. Now, of course, I don't see much, right? Because I just see the editor here. But if I look at the children of this element, I can see that there's actually an element here that has editor inside. And of course, the editor is made out of those. So let's make it a little bit better. So let's say maybe the container should have some padding. And the padding, for the padding, I need to see, like, maybe if you don't know how do I write padding, I'm gonna look at the senders of it. And I'm seeing, okay, padding actually wants something, BL insert something. Great, so I'm gonna look at that. Okay, let's see what happens. So I can see there's some sort of padding there. Actually, let's make the container add some sort of background here, maybe color blue, which is horrible, of course. So what's a terrible thing I've done?
Can you do like super light blue?
Right, let's do pale yellow, for example. I don't like this pale yellow, much better. But of course now we need to distinguish this one. So this one maybe should have a background, should be color white. So now all of a sudden I can see those differences there, right? And actually let's not put necessarily the background over here, or maybe actually it would be great to have the background. Maybe we keep this one also white. And what we will do here, say I want a container which has an aptitude, which is the air shadow aptitude. It's kind of nicer. So I'm gonna also maybe add some margin here. Yeah, okay, yeah. It doesn't like it, but yeah, this should work fine. So now I have a card, basically a 400. I kind of like this. And maybe I want to now take this one element and put it in a view here because it's just convenient. Right. So I'm going to say card four, and I'm going to say a view here. And so I have a GP view. And in this case, I'm going to say a view. And there's a view which just says explicit. So card. And I think it's called stencil here. And I'm just going to paste whatever I typed in there.
Oh my gosh.
Right. And that's it. So I have now the card, and boom, there's the card. Right. Okay. So and now, of course, you want to create a list of these, right? So now we're done with this. Now we kind of have a little object, right? It's, the tweet knows how to present itself like that. What would be nice now would be to have to build a list out of it. Just have cards one below the other, right? Something like this.
Yeah.
I actually don't know how to do it, but we can figure it out. So I think it's called something like BR simple list. That sounds like a nice thing. And there's the look at that. There's BR simple list examples. Okay, take a look at these ones. What did they do? I don't know. I can execute this. Oh, look at that. There's a bunch of lists over here. Sounds like fun. So let's take a look at this implementation. Okay, the la la self vertical list four. It's nice. So basically it tells me, okay, it's a horizontal one. That's not, it sounds too complicated for my brain at the moment. This is the horizontal one. Streaming list. No, that sounds like fun. That's that. Oh, this is the one where I have it's a stream loading of pictures.
Oh, lazy loading.
It's coming from somewhere. So what is it doing here? Okay, I have a container. Right, it does.
Now, did you write this? Did you write this code right here?
Myself?
Yeah.
I didn't.
Okay.
Why? I'm not pretending. Just curious.
What? What's that?
I'm not. I didn't do this one. No.
Okay.
My. Someone else did. This is a horizontal list. It's not nice. Vertical list. That sounds like one that I like. Look at that. Oh, that's kind of like exactly what we want. So let's do a vertical list here. Great. So BL simple list vertical. And then we have something. Oh, look at that one. This one even does an enqueue task. And oh my God.
What is that? What does that mean to you?
This one basically wants to add an action that is lazily.
So as you scroll, it adds more to the end.
Right, but we don't need that at the moment, right. So I'm gonna say I like this one, right? So item type, I don't think I need that necessarily, actually. No, so the items here are going to be, right, this is what we want. The items are going to be self tweets. And what am I doing here? I think I'm getting confused in some form here. This doesn't parse for me. Must be here, item style cell here. We need to have. Oh, okay, this one just creates a stencil, right? Oh, that's, oh, okay. Okay, that's not like the nicest thing, but we can work with this. So essentially here, I'm gonna have the data binder is going to say, you're going to take this element from here. So we're just going to say I want a build element new. Well, actually, I'm just going to do and I'm going to say here fit content. And that's the thing. I don't need to type. And then I'm going to pass it in the data binder. And then in this element is going to be exactly that pane. I'm going to say this element add child. And I'm going to say an item, which is this case, is a
one of your tweets.
Tweet.
Oh, how'd you do that?
It's magic. Command R.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. What does that mean? So, rename.
Oh, rename. Okay. Rename your method. Your,
exactly. This is the one that where actually it starts from the thing. So actually, I would love to have this one extracted in a method card element. Maybe even this card element. Card element. I'm going to go with this one. So I just extracted this method from the view because so I'm going to use it here. Card element. I don't know what I'm doing here, but let's see. Oh, look at that.
The shadow's a little...
Oh, hey! Oh my gosh!
That's cool.
Right? And the shadow is because like it needs some space, right? Yep. So...
Nice.
So I'm going to say here margin build insets all 10.
Looks better. There you go. Oh, nice. Lovely.
Right. So now we can kind of have this. And so I can just go here in this one. I'm going to say GT tweets or feed for review. And I'm going to just put them explicitly here. You can do it differently, but it's good enough. Feed, and I'm going to say stencil here. So I'm now back to where I was, and well, I have my thing. Of course, if I want to add the view, the picture here, I'll have to extract the picture, those things that have it.
And you would just to make sure I'm... So you just make another container, add the image to the container, add it to the child, and then it would show up. I mean, something like that.
In this one, we could do, right. So one thing we could do here would be to, something's off here. But one thing we could do here would be to say, I want to, when I click on this card, I should see the tweet object. This could be a nice thing to say. Right, or let's add the date at the bottom. So this could be another one. But this is how I would go about doing it. Yeah. I would need to find one that actually has pictures because I don't know how they look like.
Yeah, they're here. I'll,
I am very surprised.
Hey, Tudor, just real quick, Tudor, here's I just pasted it in. Here's the. Here's how to reach in and grab an image URL. That's helpful. Then I'd love to hear. Actually, can I tell you a sort of a funny?
Yeah, you say it. I don't know if I want to say what I'm gonna say.
Oh, so the feeling when you hear me making noises as I'm watching is like, like, you know, when you're calling methods that you don't know what they do, giving it arguments and you don't know what those are. Like I remember saw the RG element something. It's like so many of these things I ran into as I'm just trying to figure out like how do you put something on the screen. And I'm just thinking, Eric, you had your planet, you know, bouncing atoms like, God damn it. All I just want to do is have something on the screen. But so it's really awesome to sort of see what the big picture is. And it's great to see. All right. It is all about making those elements. And now I see why Tudor said about like, the view. The view is not the big thing. Once you create those elements, right, those are the kind of the important thing that you're creating. And then the view knows what to do with it. And he could do it without actually making the GT view. He was actually showing. Yeah, that's pretty
flipping. You can do it awesome. Right in the playground there.
Yeah, that's
So raw data doesn't exist in the tweet. And so
I'm sorry, that might have been after I manipulated it. Sorry.
No, it's good. No, it's actually because raw data here. I'm just going to do it for the sake of it. But... And now it's going to, I'm going to do it here. But none of it includes in my, somehow my tweets. Maybe the format changed.
I don't know. Or I might have manipulated it before I did that. That's very possibly true.
It's but, under, so oh, the, but the thing again is that we are literally this is how we program pretty much all the time.
Mm-hmm. Yeah,
we're gonna always stop and create the view of the thing we look at. In this case, the use case here is data, some sort of data exploration.
Yep.
And you can use it for reasoning about APIs. You can use it for just some data or data in the database. It doesn't matter which kind of data, right? So it's very useful for, we kind of call it, maybe it's not big data, it's deep data, right?
Yeah.
Just to understand the semantics of what's inside. But you always already get a feeling of this idea of creating first-class entities. So when we are creating domain models,
yep.
Maybe we're gonna play with this one at some point, like the planet thing or the sun, and the forest probably should also be a first class entity because it's like an interesting thing.
Mm-hmm.
The thing here is that every time you're gonna want to visualize something, you're gonna want to make that one a first class entity.
Yep,
right.
And this is such an interesting indication. This is much more powerful than. You know, like we used to have this idea of responsibility driven design where you're looking at the nouns and the verbs and
right.
And then some people say, oh, but which nouns and which verbs, because not all nouns, not all verbs. I find that this one is a much more interesting organic way to discover design.
Mm-hmm. Okay,
if you're exercising it like that.
Can I ask Eric, like, okay, he was gonna make some observations. I'm sort of dying to hear.
Well, it's I don't know how to say it. Well, I'll ask it as a question. Tudor, what do you... So you're coaching us on these things, like, you know, sometimes we'll share our screen and then you stop us and you say, wait, do it in the playground, right? But then you see us and we can't even write the code without... messing it up, right? Like we don't even get the syntax right a lot of the times. And so I'm wondering, what do you see as the difference from where we are, like at the beginning of a small talk journey, and you are way far along? Because the reason I ask is because I spent about an hour this morning. And I am just doing this planet thing. And I felt like most of my time was spent not knowing what to do next. Mm-hmm. That it was, I clicked a button and something unexpected happened. I think some of them are just UI glitches, like I clicked a button and my code went away, and then I typed the code again and I did the same thing and the code went away. And so I spent a lot of time there, and I was just so surprised when you were working to see that you didn't hit any of those.
That's not by accident.
Well, but I mean, it's probably because you have a path that every time you hit a bug, you fixed it, and I'm on a different path. But I kept expecting, oh, as soon as he clicks that, it's gonna, and then it worked. And that's why I'm trying to ask. I don't want to just say like your UI is no good. Like that's not what I'm trying to say. And I feel like it's coming out that way. This is a beautiful thing, and it's amazing what a small team can do, what your small team has done. But I just wonder, like, is the difference that you're getting it right more percentage? So like the first time you type it, you're getting the syntax right. And so you don't hit this other bug that's in the debugger, right? And I feel like
for me, it's like getting caught in the barbed wire. It's like, oh, she's but like, yeah. can I, what does your word cloud look
I
like?
I had to emotions? Start my G toolkit like three times. I had to restart it. It got in an infinite loop accidentally. And I had to kill it and restart it. And
what's the word cloud look like for your emotions? For me, it's like kind of awe and, and appreciation.
There's a lot of positive. Like I'm in awe of the mastery of this tool. But I'm also like dealing with some negative stuff. Like, I mean, what's a good word? Like, almost resentful. Resentment. Yes. Like I tried that and it didn't work. And I don't know if it's just like, I'm doing things slightly differently from you. Like, I mean, you'll watch the video and you'll see, cause I recorded it all. But I was just so shocked that it didn't happen to you. That's a shock. Like, shock.
You walked
like,
through the minefield.
I clicked that button and when I clicked it, and I'm sure there was something different. Like, well, when I clicked it, I had a syntax error.
I know what the problem is, Eric.
The
lack of positive thinking.
Lack of positive.
Positivity. Right.
So I didn't mean to get negative.
No, I'm kidding.
Because I'm very appreciative of this and I know you've spent a lot of work on it. And I know I have a long way to go anyway. And this is kind of, you know, every language has this. It's like, I remember some people were like, oh yeah, Ruby's so easy compared to Clojure. It just works right out of the box. And I go to type something and it breaks. And they're like, oh yeah, all you need to know is this other command. And you do the other command. And then I'm like, okay, I'll try this other thing. Like, oh no, you got to do it this way. And like, I mean, you're just really used to Ruby. That's why you think Clojure is hard. I'm used to Clojure and I wouldn't get into these snags. So I know there's a lot of that too, where I would learn, like, never click on that. Yeah. Anyway, what are your thoughts when I share that?
Let me unwind. So first of all, I think thanks for detailing. And I think that I don't think this is a wrong thing to feel like that. So first of all, about the difference, I'm definitely not, I'm not a reference point because this whole thing was made in a way that fits my brain.
Right.
The other thing to keep in mind is that this is actually not comfortable for most small talkers we meet.
Okay.
This way of working, it is a small talk system, but this way of working, the fact that we're programming in the inspector, the fact that the playground is like this, the fact that we're creating views all the time, the fact that we're querying things in place the way we do, the fact that we're using examples prominently there, everywhere, the fact that all of this is integrated into a documentation place, and they all reinforce each other. This is a layer on top. This is an environment that has new properties, and it takes time to learn it and to get adjusted to it on top of it being Smalltalk. Now, what you have to figuring out this path that I just showed you here, this was not straightforward. It took a lot of iterations to say, how would I do it? And like I've done problems like that maybe 100 times, 1,000 times, I don't know, many, many times, to find a path that is not, at least for me or for us, annoying. It's just a lot of work because this is not something we're not implementing here, something that somebody else has put together. This is a whole new thing. We've created a whole infrastructure, a whole new graphical stack just because we wanted to be able to expand an editor in place and see the implementations of it so that it's not.
Can I just pause it for a moment? I mean, and this is mostly to validate something. I mean, I think, Eric, seeing the DOM inspector inside of the DOM, I'm sorry, I'm using the word DOM, but that's not what I really mean, but like that, that element inspector, pardon me, Eric, this might be my ignorance, but my reaction is just dumbstruck awe. I mean, this is such a novel thing. And alien, right? I mean, like even in Google Chrome, right? Your inspector's outside of your outside of the DOM. I mean, that just blows me away. Anyway, just maybe just to show how far off the evolutionary tree we've strayed here.
So, but I mean, this is for, so for us, for example, it's not new. So if you look into the morphic history, it was there all along, right? And also the original Smalltalk, they didn't have an external anything. It was the operating system.
Right.
So it was kind of, so like, we don't even think necessarily of this, but the fact that, for example, when I do, let me just maybe quickly share this, right? So I just tweeted this, like say, for example, you want to, people ask, how do I find the shortcuts here? And of course, a static dialogue, a static documentation would be, is a way to address it. Another one is if I'll click here and I go into the scene driller, right? And then now I'm inside the editor, right? I'm one of the elements in there and I can look at the shortcuts view. And now all of a sudden I see the shortcuts that are available here. And if I click on one of those, I'm gonna see the source code that produces this one. So this is where the novel, this, the fact that I can see the DOM or the rendering tree from inside the rendering tree, that's not a big deal. But the fact that I'm using exactly the same operators to navigate to the right here, because even up to here, everything stopped here, right? For even in the DOM in the web browser, right? It just stops there. There's nothing else. But but here now, it's a simple question that I have. And now in three clicks, I just bridged two levels of meta. And now I'm in code.
Right.
Right. And so, and that's, that is it. These are the kinds of, this is what we say, that the environment is the operators.
Right.
And notice, the other thing to notice here is that when I have a view, that view, I don't just build a single narrative with that view. I can actually build many narratives, especially when I have two, three, four, five objects. Then I can build a multitude of narratives that involves a single view. And this is why, you know, if I look at this one very quickly, and then I give it to you. So if I lay, let's see how many of these views do I have, and I'm querying my system, right? And then it says, well, there are 1,700 views in this image that I'm showing you here. So 1,700 views, I can probably create hundreds of thousands or more narratives out of the box with about this system, just with the core system. And that's the difference. Like there is no other system that I know of, including the Smalltalk one, where was this readily available and a natural byproduct of the development flow.
Right.
Because this is not an extra investment. This is actually a reduction of the investment. Like it's a, we've reduced the cost. That's why we can build systems of this magnitude with a small team, because the way we work probably works.
For sure, for sure.
So I'd love to ask you, Eric, I mean, I just appreciate your,
I just want to say one other thing. So the reason you're feeling the way you do has to do a lot with the fact that this is a vehicle in which we wanted to explore how far can we go. This is not yet to a point in which it's a vehicle to teach a large population of how to get there.
Right.
Those two things are really, really different, right?
Right.
And so that's the stage of the journey we are at. And I think there is a huge space. There's very large space that is not open for how do we teach this? How do we teach this way of thinking? And some of it, like you were saying, has to do with how do I learn, you know, the immovable parts? How do I learn the language? How do I learn the things that I can reuse and probably going to change very, very little? And this is where this, for example, this newer focus on how do you teach, you know, gradually a language or an environment comes into play. But the biggest challenge, and this is left and open, and I think this is an interesting environment to exercise that, is how do you approach the rapidly changing parts without relying on your long-term memory?
Right.
So you need to build the muscles to get there. So that's a repetitive thing. But afterwards, you want to go into a place where you can tackle all sorts of open problems about which you actually don't know much. Sorry, Jim.
Yeah. I'd love to ask you. I want to put two questions on the table, Eric. And I appreciate your candor and stuff. One is the value worth the effort? Right, this is high effort, high effort, right? The question is like, what's the potential value of investment effort? And I just want to put down. I tweeted this out. Why am I doing this? Partly it was triggered by you, Eric. I want to see how one can build simple programs with UIs without having to deal with the JavaScript DOM or Java. I want to see what a truly dynamic environment really looks like and the value it creates, and see if there's something been lost in this apparently abandoned branch of the evolutionary tree. And you're wondering, like, how could Smalltalk, those early environments, be built in 180 pages of code? I want to understand why modern UIs are so difficult and cumbersome to build. And I want to see what the strange Smalltalk frontier looks like. I'm diminishing the value by calling it the Smalltalk frontier. This is your frontier, Tudor. And by the way, I got to tell you, watching that history of programming languages video of that, what was it, Steve? Him live demoing on the emulated version of the 19.
Oh, yeah. Beautiful thing.
Oh, my.
Dan Ingles.
Yeah. Oh, my God. I mean, that was probably one of the most shocking things I've ever seen. I could not have believed what I was seeing. So anyway, Eric, yeah, I would love to hear your kind of behind that resentment.
I think it's the resentment. Oh, to dig into it,
not what's behind the resentment. Is it worth powering through?
Yes, it is worth powering through. And I hope that I'm going to continue recording it, because I feel like Tudor does watch them and does want to see the pain. Absolutely. Points. I feel like a lot of the time that it takes me to write a method is being stuck and not knowing how to, some UI bug, why can't I expand my method anymore? You know, it won't expand, or, things like that. And then I close my coder and reopen it and it works now. Okay. I spent 5 minutes trying to get it to come back up, you know, things like that. So I hope that those things, I hope that you appreciate those, because I do tend to get emotional about those kinds of frustrations. But I also do see the huge value in the way you're coding. Like, just seeing that, that I like seeing that you didn't know some of the methods that you needed to call. And you could pop up the references and just scan some of the code and say, oh yeah, it's just, I got it. And just paste it in there and modify it a little bit. I know that's how code gets written, and it's much better than searching on Stack Overflow. but I liked seeing that you didn't know the stuff. And I saw a couple typos. And I didn't say anything because I wanted to see what you were going to do, to see is that going to make a debugger come up or what? And it did, and you solved it, and it was good. And I liked seeing the flow. I think I learned a lot about how you can use the playground sooner to see what's going on, and then extracting that into methods.
That was so amazing. And then an example class. God, that's so cool.
Yeah.
And the fact you could do that for those block, the BL elements. That was just, that was awesome.
And how soon you made a view of it. I would definitely not have made a view that soon. I mean, certainly not. And certainly because I don't even know how to make a view, but
can I tell you a, make a reaction, Erica? Yeah. So I watched your video too at 2x speed, and from my perspective, I was like, oh man, it makes everything look so easy. Like me, I'm like trying to.
Okay.
Well, at least I finished the daytime.
I watched myself at 2x speed. Oh, go ahead. Yeah.
Sorry, no. It's
Tudor's got some good stuff to say.
Could I maybe put one more thing? I'm actually moving off some meetings right now. I'm like, this is priceless. So even with your improperly malformed date time parser that I managed to get working, what would you do? Like, can you inform my imagination in terms of like, all right, I have one of those now, and I have the image. Like, what could I do with the date? Like you got an image, you got a date. What's now possible in terms of like what could be at hand?
You mean
besides putting in the card? Is there like a visualization of?
I don't know. We could maybe build like a bar chart per some period of time or something like this.
Yeah.
This could be imaginable, but again, like,
could you give me a tour, like just 5 minutes, like a tour of what you can do with dates in terms of like with the things that
I don't think we have anything specific here. There's not a lot out of the box that is specific for dates right now, but again, like, think of it the other way around. I always think the other way around is like, many times a simple view that you can build up quickly is many times more powerful than a fancy view that takes you maybe longer to do. So like, for example, you notice how I started with the list and then I build the columns, and then all of a sudden, just because I added that created at was actually also a data mining tool. Because I could quickly, very quickly see whether my parser rudimentary assumption about the date and time worked or not. That kind of feedback loop is priceless. And you can apply it in all sorts of ways. Now, of course, sometimes you're gonna apply, you know, use visualizations to go and learn things, but not at this stage.
Sure.
Right? It's probably later when you have some sort of more qualified type of impression. But really, at this, many use cases are super enhanced by just simple views, but many of them, many views. That's the difference. And it sometimes it's just not even interesting. I mean, it's not exciting. It's just, you know, some picture that I just have somewhere, but yeah, that's the
Tudor. I do want to say thank you.
Oh yeah, so that was.
I wanted to say, well, thank you as well. Like this, these are the things that we normally, like the experience that we have is about, it takes about a month of effort to be fluent and know where to look for things and feel comfortable about it. So feel comfortable with the environment. And the kinds of things that you do along the way, like which specific things you have implemented along the way, are maybe less interesting than making sure that you've exercised those muscles that you're gonna use over and over again afterwards. And it takes a while, right? It takes a while. To get used to those. So And for me, this is, it's very insightful to see where you're struggling, because you're not beginners, so beginners will have maybe an order of magnitude more difficulties in going through hoops, because they don't have things to approximate with. Maybe also easier in some forms. So I actually, like a couple of years ago, I met a PhD student. So she was just starting, and she gave me, like, after a couple of months, she gave me a tour. She was doing something with NLP, and she gave me a tour of her research, and she was using GT, and she basically was just showing me, like, you know, like, I don't know, a half a dozen different views, and just put them together and then explained to me how to hear algorithms and kind of things that we're applying to. And she was like ready in like 5 minutes. Wow. And I could just understand what she was doing. And then I asked her, so, well, do you understand what just happened here? And she says, what? Well, you just explained to me your research work and your agenda for, I don't know, in 5 minutes. Do you know how long it usually takes a PhD student to explain that to someone, right? Because, like, it takes a long time. And then she said, but isn't it how it's supposed to be? And then I asked her, well, have you programmed before? And she said, no. And that was, like, very surprising. So she had a math background, but for her, creating those views and using those views to make sense of things was much more intuitive than it is for programmers that are used to reason about programs without the views. That was an interesting thing. I don't know how well it scales and so, because we haven't done those kinds of experiments yet, but it was just an interesting thing. So,
cool. So how do you want to spend, if we go another 20 minutes, I'm not sure, Eric, that works for you, but, okay, great. Main thing I would propose is, can we learn how to, push our code someplace where it doesn't get,
you have to
go into recovery mode. That seems like it would be high leverage. I'm actually afraid to upgrade my image because I'm so afraid of losing my work. Yeah,
of course.
So, Eric, do you have any other things,
let's do it.
Topics?
Let's do that. Priority number
right.
one.
So, okay. So, to this end, let's go and create a GitHub repository.
On GitHub or on.
So, who's going to do it? Who's going to drive it?
Eric, yeah, sure.
How do you have such a black background, Tudor?
It's part of the magic. It's basically there's a green screen behind me.
Oh, cool. Do you ever put anything else behind you?
No.
Why didn't you just make it black?
White.
Why do you need a green screen and then digitally? Okay, I'm joking.
It's not black enough.
I see.
But sometimes I want it white, so.
Thanks for listening to me with my emotions, Tudor.
No, seriously, like, this is very, very useful.
I was imagining when you were typing the code so quickly and making stuff go. I've done
the license.
Oh.
I don't think you can do it now.
No, too late.
But you can edit afterwards. Yeah, you can say new add file.
Okay.
On the top right. And license capital. Yeah, no, just license, and it should be without the C.
God, I am.
And then you can choose from the top right. You can say choose.
How many books have you written, Gene?
This is fascinating.
It's good.
Yeah. Actually, I'm. Wow. All right. Cool.
Thank you. Then you have to commit it to the bottom. No, don't create the bench.
Dude, actually, as the years go by, misspellings are less obvious to me. My ability to spell is actually going down. Okay.
You need a teacher with a ruler.
All right. Okay, I got a
open Glamorous Toolkit.
Okay,
let's just go to right now to the morphic world. There is a tool that's not ready in the Glamorous Toolkit world yet to browse. Iceberg. That's because, you know, Git is a large beast. So you can say here, add. Okay, and we're going to say GitHub, clone from GitHub. And you're going to say first owner is real Gene Keem.
Owner.
Real Gene Keem, right? No.
Oh.
It's your username.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah, and then it's learning-g toolkit. And so just a second. So here, it's going to be, just a second.
Yeah.
If you look into, you have to specify what your keys are. And
your keys?
Yeah. So you have to tell Iceberg where are your keys. The SSH keys. And
okay,
to
well,
do
after
this,
I hit okay. Oh yeah, sorry.
Just a second. To do this, the simplest thing is to just execute this in the command line. I pasted something in Slack.
Thank you.
So if you run this. Wow, that's tiny. Okay, so just run this. Okay, so you don't, where are your SSH keys?
I have a
keys. You should, okay, it's probably ED, whatever those things.
Yep.
Or is it Google Compute? One of those.
Oh, man.
So you have to add them to your keychain?
Do I do that? Okay.
So these, okay, let's assume that this is the one that you have. Okay. And okay, so now you clone and say, okay. Okay, so now here you don't have, this is just an empty project. There's nothing in there. So click on it, right click.
Oh.
Okay, or this, repair. Okay. There's an icon on the top left.
Okay.
So here it says create project metadata.
Roger.
Right.
Okay.
Yeah. And so, and then here choose format, no, the other format. Tonal. Okay, and just a second. No.
Yep.
Create a directory here. Make it src, for example. Just create. There's a plus button on the top right. All right. Just say src.
Yeah.
Okay, and then click on that. You have to select it. No.
Oh wait. Okay. Did I do something bad?
Yeah. Right.
Okay. Chest it over.
Repository? No. In the repository, I think it's possible. If you click on the repository.
Yeah.
No, there's an icon called repository in the repository.
Oh, repository. Window. Yeah. Roger.
Maybe right click on it because we have to. Let's close this one.
Okay.
I forgot how do we modify this? Yeah. And close this one as well.
Okay.
Right click here. Let's see if maybe that would work. No, the first your. Edit. Right. So click on SRC. So yeah. We want the sources to be stored there, right? So what happens here? You now created, you downloaded from Git, but now yep. You need to tell the image where it should mirror things that is in the that are in the image and export them to file. So that's what you did. And yep. At the bottom, you said in which format should the serialization happen? There's an older one and there's a newer one. Donnell is the newer one. And so you say, okay, now.
Okay,
great. Now you have specified a repository, a mapping of a repository and where that repository is on disk and how it should be stored there. Now you have packages. Packages at the image level, right? So now yep. You have to go into this repository.
Okay.
Double click or so. Or packages, yeah.
There we go. Uh-huh.
Now you say plus add package. And so yeah. I think it was, what is it? Now
GK. I can search.
You can do GK. Yeah. Maybe capital. Maybe it's.
Oh.
Right. Enter.
Oh. So afraid of hitting enter.
I think your package was different. Can you check the name of the package?
Yeah, Roger.
So it's the other window.
GK.
It's called GK2Tweet, indeed. So you should find it in there. GK. So obviously that's not the best possible interface, but it's
okay. Got it. Yes, found it.
It does the job for this. So I said okay.
Okay.
Ooh. And now you have your package there.
All right.
Now you can say commit. You can commit. All right. So commit and da 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 da. It has.
Look at Eric. Things. I overloaded as string.
Nice. Cool.
S string is not in the is not nice. Overload. It's print string is
oh
it's good.
Oh wait. Oh I should say that again. Oh, you saw print string somewhere?
No, it should have been print string, not S string.
Oh damn it.
But it's okay, it's good.
Okay, good.
So just a second, I'll give put some comment there because we're not. Okay, and then yeah, you can save the yeah, you can push if you want, or
yeah.
And then here there's another checkbox here which automatically will save the image when you
yeah. commit,
which can be okay or not, but you can let's give it like this and commit.
All right.
Okay. Now, sorry, it didn't work. No, I don't think it will work. Oh, you can try, but I think something is missing there.
Can I save as global? I'm not waiting for him to say yes. I'm just doing it.
I can push. I did not push. Should have pushed. I pushed. So now if you refresh, you have the
there's
source
your code.
Oh, I've recognized. I see this every once in a while. Yeah, I've seen these.
Nice.
Cool.
Okay, so now if we go back to we're still not quite done because what would be cool would be to have a single script with which to load the whole code in a single
load the whole code.
Instruction.
Okay.
Right. So because now you have a package, but to load it would be I need to import the repository and from it.
Okay, got it.
Load the package manually. So here's where we enter in the territory of configuration management, right? So NPM for JavaScript, Maven for Java,
yeah,
you name it, for whatever. So here, this is called Metacello. That's the name of the engine.
Yeah.
And Metacello, yeah.
Because
like the previous one was called Monticello. It's complicated. It doesn't matter. Metacello, that's the
inside
name.
Inside jokes.
And then we have... let's take a look at something that is maybe simple. Let's take a look at the baseline of G Toolkit examples.
Okay, you want me to look for a baseline of
G Toolkit.
All right.
Examples, G Toolkit.
All right.
Okay. Enter.
Enter.
Engine would have been better. Engine? The one below it. The one below it.
Examples engine. Got it. Oh, by the way, I have a question about this. Yeah. So how do I get this to dock someplace? You told me how to do that. Is that no? Is that
the book? It's the book. The book.
Book. Okay. Got it. Thank you. All right. Okay. Yeah. Sorry.
It's all, you're already in it. So
here you No. So, sometimes, like when I'm trying, I found something interesting. Right. I didn't know how to put it in the box. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Okay. Got it. Okay. Cool. Thank you.
Okay. So you see, you have their baseline.
Yeah.
That method. Okay. So this one, that's the one that specifies what makes this project. So I would create a class called, so notice how here you have a class, which is in this a package with the same name, and it has a baseline method that is annotated with baseline and specifies a bunch of packages. It can also specify other projects that reside in other repositories as dependencies, and those will be also taken over. So what you need to do is you need to create another class, which is called baseline of learning gtoolkit.
All right, this is actually, so this is exactly where I wanted to dock. Okay,
so yeah, I'm gonna save this. You're gonna dock this, maybe enlarge the window so that we see. You know, maximize this window. Yeah. And maybe pick one of those. And simplest thing may actually, maybe it's not, but could it is, let's create another class here.
Yeah.
And should be baseline of learning with gtoolkit.
Oh, wait. Learning. Say again, baseline of?
Learning with gtoolkit. That's what you, learning gtoolkit, sorry.
Learning.
Okay. Does it really matter?
No, but it's nice to have. So you will see that once you name your repository in some way, you will see, oh, actually, this is what I need to load in that repository. You will look.
Okay.
Say enter.
Enter.
And now, actually, you need a package with the same name.
Roger.
Wait, you got to hit enter. You have to enter.
Ooh, yeah, okay. Right.
And this one is something's not right there. You have to delete that.
Oh.
Not like this. Escape. It won't work. Escape.
Oh, I tried to do this once. Okay.
Delete now. No, actually, no. It does work. No, actually. Just, double click and delete the text. Yes. Okay, good. And now I say okay.
Okay.
Great. And now we create the baseline method.
Roger.
And actually go here and copy it from there.
Yeah.
It's baseline colon. This won't work. Yeah, colon. And then you need to say, I think it's spec, the typical variable.
Oh, I thought I forgot.
Just copy the whole thing. I would really command A and
I did. I'm trying. I did a command A. It's not.
What did you do? Command A.
I absolutely did command A.
Now, if you do now command A, doesn't select everything?
No, this happens to me a lot. It's like command A did not work.
How can that be?
I don't know, man.
Man, let's see. What kind of software are we building here?
You said it, not me, thing. Man.
I'm
kidding.
Just paste the whole thing. Just
That's interesting. Command V doesn't work.
Your command is stuck. So we can kind of see it. Can you actually press command multiple times? Just command, just because it kind of gets stuck.
Okay.
And you didn't copy it either.
Oh, dang. Okay. No problem.
Okay.
I like this. My command is.
Can you try command A just because?
I am.
Okay, then try like this. Command tab and back. Just command tab to something else.
Yeah.
And now back. Not Tricomon. So this is a one of those ugly bugs that just annoying. Okay, so just say okay.
Actually, thank you. That was actually super helpful, Tudor, showing how to get it unstuck.
Okay, so now of course your package should here be.
Yeah.
Go in that in there. Just delete the whole thing for once. Yeah, delete the whole thing.
Delete.
I mean the whole string, right?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Okay, now try typing, but not too fast. G, capital G, K, try. Not too fast. G, K, 2. And if you press control space, what happens?
Control space?
Why not? That's interesting. Okay, anyway, tweets. Yeah.
Actually, I get confused. How do I verify that's the name of the GK? Is that it? GK2 tweet?
Yeah. You said the name of the package, right?
Yeah, GK2 tweet. Oh, yeah, GK2 tweet. All right, good.
No, control space.
Control space.
I don't understand. Can you delete the T in there? Or just go, can you go in the one?
Okay, yeah.
Control space, yeah.
Command space, maybe?
Control space.
No, control space.
Oh. Negative.
Is it in the package list?
Well, it must be because that's what he was writing before.
G.
Wait.
GK2 tweet. Cool. All right.
Can you try just for the sake of it? Just can you go into this in the G Toolkit examples engine?
Yeah.
The tab. So Command Shift to the left. Oh. Yeah, and just delete the S in the first package. Right now, can you press Control Space there?
Oh yeah, that worked. Yeah.
Okay, so this one works, but yours doesn't. I wonder why that is. Okay, I don't know why that is. But
the
interesting thing here is that you get actually completion in the string, right?
Yep.
That's because here the editor is molded to this library. So the context here is
library. So it recognizes the baseline pragma?
Yeah, it recognizes the whole construct there. Mm-hmm. And then it knows that string is actually should look up the package name.
Sure would be nice, Tudor. I'm just kidding. Yeah.
But delete the semicolon and the second package.
Got it.
You still need a close square bracket.
Bang. Yeah.
Okay. So now save this.
Yep. Yep.
Okay. So you have baseline of learning toolkit, maybe G toolkit, or.
Okay, no problem.
Okay, enter.
Do I have now to change the class?
There's a, wait. No. Like here you have now said, I want to perform a refactoring, and then a button appeared. But now this one actually tells you, wait. Now expand the rename, because it might be that it is used already somewhere, and so the one actually tells you where. Okay, obviously it's only used here, so you can say, okay.
Nice.
So now you have applied that one. You're going to see, like, if you're renaming a method, you're going to have the same kind of thing. A button will appear to say, press OK. So save this one. But now you also have to actually go and refactor the, So click on the package on the left-hand side.
Oops.
The package. Okay, baseline. Okay, get that one. Exactly. It's good. And now again, do the same thing on the package name, because we also need to rename the package. They should be named the same.
Yeah.
At the top. No.
Right here?
No, this is a class.
You were
there as well. Yeah. Okay.
Oh, here. Got it. Damn it. Oh, wait. Hang on.
That's the one. It's good.
That's it.
Okay.
So now double click of baseline of learning G Toolkit.
Right here? Yeah. No.
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 the top
of learning toolkit.
Oh, right here. Learning toolkit. Okay.
Okay. Now again, enter. Yeah, it's okay. This one's not going to have much of anything. Okay. So, okay.
All right.
So now you have the specifications, which is another package. Now, how do we make the package appear in your GitHub repository?
Okay.
How?
I have to imagine you have to bind it in here somewhere.
So,
baseline of learning. Okay.
And now? It's green, which basically means it's obviously because it's not committed. So.
Yeah.
So add baseline. Okay. Okay.
All right. So wait, so that's like the manifest.
Is it pushing? Yeah, so exactly.
The something. Right. It's the,
and then yeah. Will this load it now? Or
yes. Right. Well, and actually, now let's go and open a playground. You can actually try in a new image if you want or if you have any, but
I mean, I suppose there's no reason not to, right?
Right. So keep this one there.
Oh.
Keep this one, right?
But yeah.
Close it. Open another one.
Yeah. In fact. Might as well do this now. Is it finished yet? Almost, yeah. Boom. Dog. Semi. Okay. Glamorous toolkit. Glamorous toolkit. No, not Eric's movie. That was great. Won't have to be worried about losing my stuff. Okay. Second image. Sorry, one sec. All right. So of course, my stuff isn't going to be in here.
Of course.
Iceberg.
So I'm just gonna paste here.
Yeah.
What you should be writing. What is it? Baseline of learning G toolkit, right? And mm-hmm. It was in real Gene Keen. And then in the repository, learning G toolkit. I think.
Folks, I have to go.
Right on. Hey, I have done this before, believe it or not. So I put this into a playground. That's how we got the Z timestamp stuff working.
Oh, can you just drop that in a playground?
Yeah, you're going to just run this one in the playground. And try it.
Sorry, go.
So the baseline of learning. Oh, we made a mistake. We have to subclass baseline of in the other image.
Yeah.
See you. Thank you so much, Tudor. Thank you, Gene.
Eric, thanks, great. Eric. As always. Should we shoot for another time?
Yeah.
Do you want to do same time next week?
Let me check my calendar.
Works for me.
Yeah, I think it's good.
All right, I'll send you an invite. Good times, Eric. Thanks.
Yeah, likewise. Thank you, Tudor. Thank you, Gene.
See you, Eric.
go into the other image. Oh, I'm getting confused. Okay. Other image. Yeah, other...
The one with the large window.
Yeah.
There you are. So here in the class, it shouldn't be subclassing object. It should be subclassing baseline of.
Baseline of.
That one. Yeah. Enter.
Enter.
Okay, and now again, like you have to say okay, and again, like this is a refactoring.
Yeah.
It's harmless, so okay. Yep. And now you have to go to your Git interface and commit it. You don't have to select.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Yes.
Yeah. Now, here's where it gets a little bit confusing.
Oh, wait, I didn't push. Okay, there it is. Yeah.
It's pushed, okay. So if you now go to your other image, it will tell you exactly the same error.
Yeah.
Why? Wait, why?
Yeah.
You can try if you want, but it will tell you exactly the same. The reason why is because this code that you have in this new image is still the old code. Now let's actually quickly take a look why, because it's useful here. Actually a useful exercise. So close this one. And just in there, just let's browse the local folder. So quote dot quote as file reference.
Ooh. Oh. No, for a small.
You need an as, should be more. No space in between as and. Oh. Yeah, delete that space. As. And no, yeah, and capital F. Mm-hmm. And I'll inspect that. Go in, let's go into the tree view. Tree view there. And in the Pharo local, yeah, expand it. Okay, so then you have ice, yeah. You have iceberg, and then you have real gene key. Yeah. So this is your copy of Git, right? It's already there.
Yeah.
And so if the image says, oh, I already have a thing is there, I'm not going to take a new one.
I'm not going to.
Because it's already on the disk.
Okay.
So you don't need to say. There are two options here. Either we simulate from, we go from scratch and then load it again, or we can go and force this copy that I already have to fetch the latest one.
Fetch pull. Okay, yeah.
I think that we should, so what I would do now, just so that you can see how it is when you take a fresh image and load in a fresh image, I would close this image, delete the real gene keme subfolder from there, and then do this whole exercise again. So got I would close this image. And actually you can close it, yeah. Close it and then we'll do the next step afterwards.
Okay, so now I only have one Glamorous toolkit running.
Right. And now you have this, right, in Pharo local here, you still have Pharo local iceberg real gene
key. Oh, yeah.
Delete that folder.
Oh, just go ahead and delete it as a fresh image?
No, not the whole thing, just the iceberg one.
Iceberg.
And in the iceberg. Okay.
Should I just delete
the. Like, it could be that you might have others.
Configs. Right? Okay, yeah.
But in this case, you don't, so it's totally fine to delete also the whole iceberg thing. Okay, great, like this. And now if you open again Glamorous Toolkit.
Roger.
You can take your playground and, well, in fact, you already have this page.
No, I just made it.
If you shift, no.
What?
You already have the previous page, right? Because it was saved.
Oh.
So if you do shift enter here.
Yeah.
And say learning. No, not playground, because that's right. Then enter. Then that's your playground.
Got it.
And now you can execute it. Yeah.
Roger.
And then so now it executed it.
Oh, it's done. Okay. Uh-huh.
Yeah. And now you can go to your other previous pages and the one with files and tweets. Right. And there you have your other things.
Oh, and it's loaded.
And it's loaded.
Yeah, in fact, oh, look what I did while you were talking to Eric. I made an example.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, okay, well, maybe I did. All right.
So now what I would do now, just a final thing, and then like this, it's easy afterwards to retrieve it. Go to the previous, the playground on the previous one. So the,
yeah.
If you maximize this.
Yeah. Wait, this one, no, right? The old one?
No.
No?
No, no. I mean, the here, look at the playground with the Metacello script.
Ah, yes.
Learning.
On. Learning.
Or Metacello or learning. Mm-hmm. And the pages, yeah. Okay. What? Give this a name. So take the playground and say load, I don't know, learning G toolkit.
Right. So here would be where I need to explicitly. Oh, yeah. Okay, got it. Sorry. Yeah.
So now next time you're going to open this one, you just say download G toolkit, shift enter, learning, enter, play, boom.
Love it. Love it. Mm-hmm. All right, cool. That's awesome. Okay. And now I can actually get rid of the old image.
Yes. You're free from your prison.
Yeah. Awesome. Cool. Okay. Thank you, Tudor. I'm going to start recording. Stop recording.